Welcome to the chapel service at the Institute of Lutheran Theology. It is good to have you join us today. Reverend Timothy J. Swenson here, and I welcome you on behalf of the staff, faculty, and students of the Institute. We begin our service today in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Join in our litany. Turn again, O God of hosts.
Look down from heaven and see.
Have regard for this vine and the stock that your right hand planted.
And for the Son whom you made strong for yourself.
They have burned it with fire. They have cut it down.
May they perish at the rebuke of your face.
But let your hand be on the man of your right hand. Then we shall not turn back from you.
Give us life, and we will call upon your name.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you have endured the doubts and foolish questions of every generation. Forgive us for trying to be judge over you, and grant us such faith that we cannot help but confess you as our Lord. Amen. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 21st chapter. Hear another parable. There was a master of a house who planted a vineyard and put a fence around it, and dug a wine press in it, and built a tower, and leased it to tenants, and went in to another country. When the season for fruit drew near, he sent his servants to the tenants to get his fruit. And the tenants took his servants and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other servants, more than the first, and they did the same to them. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, "They will respect my son." But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, "This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and have his inheritance." And they took him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. When therefore the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? They said to him, "He will put those wretches to a miserable death and let out the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the fruits in their seasons." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the Scripture? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people producing its fruits. And the one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and when it falls on anyone, it will crush him." When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they perceived that he was speaking about them. And although they were seeking to arrest him, they feared the crowds, because they held him to be a prophet. The Gospel of the Lord. Greetings to you. Greetings on this day that the Lord has made, a day for us to rejoice and be glad. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from His Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, "This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and have his inheritance." This parable of the tenants is thrown in the face of Jesus' interlocutors as they examine him in the temple. They are testing, probing, searching for any fault, any imperfection. Jesus stands there before them like the Passover lamb stands tethered there in the temple too. undergoing a similar examination as to its worthiness for sacrifice. This parable of the tenants is thrown in the face of the chief priests and the elders of the people and the Pharisees, those of respectable ilk, of scholarly learning, and of exemplary piety. It is thrown in their face. Yet another insult from this itinerant preacher, occasional miracle worker, and sometimes resurrector of the dead. From this one whom they wanted to arrest, whom they wanted to silence. He'd already proved them incompetent. They didn't know by what authority John baptized. He'd already proven their lack of faith. The tax collectors and prostitutes will go ahead of you into the kingdom of God. And now with this insult, he hoists them on their own petard. They said to him, "He will utterly destroy those evil men. Then he will lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him his portion at the harvest." Jesus skewered them with their own words and hung them out to dry. The chief priests and elders of the people had occupied positions. They had occupied the temple and its environs. They had held their places at the top of the religious heap for so long, they'd begun to think they'd a right to them. A right to them until Jesus came. Until Jesus came and said, "For this reason I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken from you and given to a people who will produce its fruits." They had occupied their place for so long, they thought they had a right to it, until Jesus came and exposed that all they had as a right was merely a squatter's right. Squatter's rights is an old custom flowing out of the ancient maxim, "Possession is 9/10 of the law." That maxim was first codified in Scottish expression, "Possession is 11 points in the law, and they say there are but 12. The principle became a staple of the American West, fueling the conflict between the cattle barons and other squatters on the land. The concept was briefly resuscitated by the Occupy movement of 2011. Even internet memes play off of it. Witness the popularity of this one. Holding a grudge is like letting someone live rent-free in your head. Squatters' rights have received definitive treatment in the legal code under the heading adverse possession, a method of gaining legal title to real property by the actual, open, hostile, and continuous possession of it to the exclusion of its true owner for the period prescribed by state law. Actual, open, hostile, continuous possession to the exclusion of the true owner. How did those tenants in the parable, the ones who stood in for the chief priests and elders, how well did they track with these defining conditions of adverse possession? Did they have squatter's rights? They had actual possession. Yes, the vineyard was theirs to tend. Did they possess it exclusively? Certainly. Nobody but them benefited from it. Did they possess it with hostility? Yes, they possessed it with hostility, refusing payment, beating, and killing the rent collectors. Did they possess it continuously? Yes, for season after season. Did they do all this to the exclusion of the true owner? Yes. They even killed his son to exclude him. Those tenants had a reasonable expectation of squatters' rights. But even the chief priests and the elders of the people recognized that possession may be 9/10 of the law, but possession is not ownership. What matters? Possession. When the authority of the owner can strip that possession right away from you, he will put those tenants to a miserable death and let out the vineyard to others. So too do you, my fellow sinners, possess a life of which you are not the owner. Through the years, that possession has resulted in your assumption of squatter's rights. An adverse possession claiming ownership of the life you merely possess, that you merely squat upon. Like those wicked tenants, like those presumptuous chief priests, elders, and Pharisees, like them, you sinners fulfill the elements of adverse possession: actual, open, exclusive, hostile possession. Fellow sinners, you and I actually possess this life, don't we? Look, no strings. There's no secret operator, no hidden controller, no dungeon master casting the dice to determine our fate. Sinners define personhood by the actual competent possession of their life. Sinners possess their life openly and notoriously. Of course, you try to hide your sin, but you're infamously obvious about possession of your own life. Listen to yourselves. Who is the subject of your sentences? I gave my heart to Jesus. I invited Jesus into my heart. I just want to do God's will. You are notorious for possessing yourself. Not only open and notorious, but exclusive possession as well. When the Lord sends his agents, when the Lord sends your neighbors to receive the fruit yielded from your possession of your life, how many times have you run them off? I don't have time for that now. I'm busy. Can we deal with this later? No guests allowed at your little tea party. Only me, myself, and I. Actual, open, exclusive, and now hostile. Yes, we sinners possess this life in hostility toward its true owner. If running off the neighbors, shutting down those closest to you right there in your own family with excuses about time, if running them off isn't hostile enough, there's always the Son. The true owner of your life, the master of the entire creation's economy, the one with true authority, sent his Son, the Son, to deal with you, to deal with me, with each and every sinner squatting on the life the Father owns. Listen to his word: all lives are mine. But sinners took the life of the Son, silencing the owner's claim against their possession of squatter's rights. Without interruption, we sinners continuously assert such rights day after day until our mortality takes us. Sinners have each and every element of adverse possession in staking out a claim against the true owner of their lives. But of course, there is interruption. The Lord's mercies are new every day. So that you will hear of them, the Lord sends you a preacher. He sends someone to deliver His Son to you, the Son who confronts you with the consequences of your adverse possession. Jesus Christ gets a hold of your ears, just like He had the ears of the chief priests and the elders of the people. He gets a hold of your ears, demonstrating to you that you're as incompetent as were they. He insults you in your possession of life. Jesus Christ, Him crucified and Him alone, is the only authority the owner needs to strip your squatter's rights from you, to strip possession of your squatter's rights away. Jesus Christ and Him crucified is the only authority the owner needs to fulfill this prophecy. He will put those tenants to a miserable death and let out the vineyard to others. A miserable death for miserable sinners interrupts the continuity of our squatter's rights. Your old Eve, my old Adam, all tenancy of this old creation must pass away. The owner is letting out the vineyard to a new tenant. The new you. The new you in Christ Jesus. The new you in the new creation. The new you belongs to that nation bearing the fruits of the kingdom of God. The new you is of the people who produce the fruits of the kingdom. The new you makes no squatter's claims to possess life. The new you knows from whom life is received, knows its true owner. The new you says with the psalmist, "Give us life, and we will call upon your name." And give it he does. I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the body of Christ, the blood of Christ, given and shed for you. I forgive you all your sins. Font, altar, pulpit, the Lord's life handed over, given to you for your fruitfulness in the kingdom of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray. Each petition will invite your response with, "Lord, in your mercy," and your response will be, "Hear our prayer." Heavenly Father, continue to send us preachers of Christ, Him crucified and Him alone, that we might receive your mercies new every day. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, as you establish us in Jesus Christ and His new creation, draw forth from us such fruit that our neighbors benefit and rejoice at their abundance. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, draw forth from the students here at ILT the best of their efforts, that they would better proclaim your word. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father in heaven, place your hand of protection around your church wherever it is persecuted for your name's sake. Give relief to Karen with burning mouth syndrome. Provide remission to Diane's pastor's wife. And grant relief and pardon to all who suffer under the brokenness of sin. Father in heaven, grant to those of us at the Institute of Lutheran Theology, students, faculty, and staff, the joy of useful and fruitful labor. Bring the Institute to full flower as that place where your word blossoms. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, Heavenly Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you for joining us in our chapel service. We are glad to bring you the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You may leave prayer requests in the comments below. They will be included in an upcoming chapel service. Please visit our website, ilt.org, to find more materials for use in your congregation and in your home. Once again, thank you for your participation.